Hello, and thanks for joining me today on what will be a bit of an adventure. Today we're going to try three different tensors at three vastly different price points in an effort to widen the scope of our palette in physics and math. I will warn you though that this video will go from 0 to 100, so you might want to buckle up because it'll be a bit of a wild ride. I'm joined in this video by Andrew Dodson, who will take us through today's delicacy item, the energy momentum tensor. But first, I've scraped together some loose change to purchase today's budget items. So let's have a look at what's in here. First of all, I have my order number. Now, since this is just a simple number or a scalar with no direction needed to describe this single component, it would be a tensor of rank 0. It wouldn't change if I change my coordinate system. This would read 142 no matter how I look at it. So let's see what else I have in here. Well, I also have some greasy vectors. Now, if I wanted to describe the length and orientation of this chip, I could do so using a vector that has a magnitude and direction. Since I'm in 3D space, I could set up a XYZ axis and describe it using three components. Because each of those three components could be described using one direction, this would be a tensor of rank 1. And if I changed my coordinates, it would change how I write the vector, but it wouldn't change the vector itself. For our mid-level price point, we could consider a slab of jelly, which will have various stresses inside, which are internal forces between neighboring parts of the material. These forces keep the material in place, and if I was to cut it in half, then the two pieces would deform slightly. There are tangential shear forces as well as perpendicular forces to consider at each point. If we consider the point right at the center of each of our jellies, call it point O, we could describe all of the forces on O as a tensor. If we were to make a cut in the Y plane, it would expose the face, which is perpendicular to the X direction. And we would see the part where O would have been experiencing forces from the front half of the jelly. Call these forces PXX, PXY, and PXZ. We could repeat this for a cut which exposes the face of the jelly, which is perpendicular to the Y direction, and again for a face that will be perpendicular to the Z direction. Considering the forces on each of these faces, we would end up with a matrix with 9 components. The first index of each component would refer to the direction that each face is perpendicular to, and the second index would refer to the direction of the force on that face. Because two directions are used to describe each component, this would be a tensor of rank 2. This tensor is also invariant under a coordinate transform, and in fact all of these tensors are invariant because when operated on by a coordinate transform, the magnitude of the components of the tensor change according to that transform, whilst the basis vectors or the directions of the components change in an inverse manner, allowing the entire tensor to be invariant. Andrew is now going to tell us about a rank 2 tensor in 4 dimensions, and this is where things get a little bit fancy. If you struggle to keep up, Andrew does have a lot of other videos about tensors on his channel, but I at least hope that even if you don't totally know what's going on, you can still appreciate the elegance of the dish.
What got me into tensors? Well, definitely my dear friend John Mayer. Hey John, do you have something to say about that?
I met Andrew back in 2006. It was after I wrote the song Gravity. And at the time, people were fascinated with understanding the meaning of the song and who the inspiration for it was, rather, which was so disappointing because to me, the song wasn't about a person. It was, I thought, clearly about the energy momentum tensor. And Andrew knew that. He reached out to me on MySpace and we got to talking about its properties and where it pops up in physics, which I think is what he's going to be talking about here shortly. And we've just been rocking ever since. But once you understand how the tensor fits into the song, you see how it just writes itself. Here, let me play the entire thing. No, that's alright. Shut up, John Mayer. What's going on, smart people? Level 12 Tensor Boi here to talk about the Energy Momentum Tensor. Without a doubt, one of my favorite tensors. I just think it's the coolest. I'll get to why a little bit later, but for now, let's just talk about what it is. So from the name, you've probably gathered that it's a tensor. It is a second-ranked tensor, which means that if we can calculate its components in one basis, let's call that T alpha lambda. So as long as my big head isn't in the way, which I'm sure it is, T alpha lambda, and someone else calculates it in another basis, say in the prime frame T mu nu, please don't make fun of my mus, I'm super self-conscious about them. These two are related by two transformation coefficients. So it's gonna be a dx prime mu dx alpha dx prime nu dx lambda. This is the transformation rule for a second rank contravariant tensor. Now, whenever someone says something transforms as a tensor, your question should always be, under what transformations are we considering? And typically, if you see something indexed with Greek indices, that means we're probably considering Lorentz transformations. That's something that you can infer. So for fields like quantum field theory or special relativity, that's what we're going to be considering. If you go to more something like general relativity, you're widening your scope to more general coordinate transformations called diffeomorphisms. We're not going to be getting that technical in this video. We will talk a little bit about general relativity, but just throwing that buzzword at you, that's something to consider. But you should always know what transformations you're considering. Now, if we're indexing it with the Greek letters, that typically means the letters are going from 0 to 3, 0 being the time index, and 1 through 3 being spatial bits. Now, if we want to know what these components are, it's very common to represent the tensor components as matrix elements. All second-rank tensors can be represented as square matrices, but not all square matrices are tensors. That is important, and I've made a video showing a counterexample of that. But let's go ahead and throw all of these components into a square matrix. We have going from 0 to 3 here, 0 to 3 here, so that's going to be a 4x4 matrix. Great, we threw it all in a matrix. Let's talk a little bit about the physics that it represents. So formally, it's defined in terms of a flux of 4 momentum, P mu, 4 momentum because it has 4 components, transforms as a 4 vector. So it's a flux of 4 momentum P mu across some surface at constant x nu. That's helpful, right? No? Okay, let's try to make that a little bit more tangible, because at first that didn't really mean anything to me either. So really, the energy momentum tensor, at least in the context of general relativity, is kind of like a generalization of the matter density that you use in, say, Newtonian physics, that rho on the side of Poisson's equation. So with that, it kind of follows that this term here, T00, at least if we're looking at, say, some fluid, some infinitesimal patch of a fluid in its rest frame, this is going to represent its energy density. Okay, energy density. And once we want totals, we can just integrate over all space. Similarly, in that same frame, we can take a look at these terms here. And these are going to be momentum densities. Okay, that's also kind of like an energy flux. Now this bottom right block probably deserves a bit more of an explanation. I'm also out of different colors, so I'm just going to use indexing. So all the ones, twos, and threes and combinations, not the zeros, I'm just going to call that Tij. So Ij are either 1, 2, or 3. That has a name, and it's called momentum flux. Momentum flux. And for the momentum flux, it's split into two different categories. The diagonal terms, which are pressure, and the off-diagonals, which are shear stress. So for I equal to J, that's pressure. It's not too hard to see how that's related to momentum and energy. Pressure is, you know, force divided by area. It's a force being applied perpendicular to a surface, like punching your hand. And force is just the time derivative of the momentum. Now, for the energy, it's kind of like if you compress a piston full of gas, you increase the internal energy. Now, for the shear stress, it's a little bit more subtle. So for I not equal to J, so that's these terms, shear stress. if the pressure is kind of like punching the surface of your hand and the shear stress is like rubbing them together, it's like the force being applied parallel to the surface. Before all the engineers comment in the comment section, it doesn't have to be, it can also be perpendicular. That's just not the main takeaway. As far as the energy goes, the piston analogy for pressure, for the shear stress, it's like twisting an object. So in the context of general relativity, the shear stress terms could pop up if you're looking, say, at a fluid that has non-zero viscosity. So if you have a perfect fluid, these off-diagonal terms would just be zero. Cool. Part of the reason I like the energy momentum tensor so much is because of how important it is in general relativity. General relativity is governed by the Einstein field equations, and the energy momentum tensor is literally the other half of the equation. This is the covariant version, but it amounts to the same thing. Now on the left-hand side we have the metric tensor, and much like how in differential equations your solution usually isn't just a number, that would be boring, it's a function. In the same sense, the field equation's solution is the metric tensor. Now I say equations because this isn't just one equation. Each of these objects is a second-rank tensor, and as we saw, those had 16 components. So this is actually 16 equations, but because of symmetry, it reduces down to you only having to solve 10 partial differential equations. The metric tensor contains information regarding the geometry of the space-time, from which you can deduce if your space is curved at all by calculating what's called the Riemann curvature tensor. Now that's not explicitly shown in the field equations, but the contraction of the Riemann curvature tensor gives you this object, which is called the Ricci tensor. Now taking the trace of the Ricci tensor gives you the Ricci scalar. Scalars are nice, it's a nice invariant. And then over here we have the cosmological constant because dark energy. So the left-hand side of the equation is all about the geometry of space-time. And as we know now, matter and energy is represented in the form of the energy momentum tensor. Now the energy momentum tensor is defined T mu nu is equal to minus 2, 1 over root minus g, and then it's a functional derivative of the action with respect to the metric, where the g without the index corresponds to the determinant of the metric. Okay, so this is how you actually define the energy momentum tensor. And now that you know all of this, you can finally understand the famous expression that says, matter tells space-time how to curve, and curved space-time tells matter how to move. Now, the fact that the energy momentum tensor is defined in terms of the metric actually leads to a very important result. It stems from the fact that the metric tensor is symmetric, which means that if I swap mu with nu, nothing should change. There are theories where that doesn't hold that are said to have torsion. That does not apply to us here. And it can't for the sake of consistency, for logical consistency, because this not being symmetric, say we have some point here and two paths connecting it, A and B. The metric tensor not being a symmetric tensor would be like saying the angle between A and B is different from the angle between B and A. That just doesn't make sense. The metric tensor has to be a symmetric tensor. And because the energy momentum tensor is defined in terms of it the way that it is, it guarantees that the energy momentum tensor is also symmetric. Now, the energy momentum tensor isn't only used in general relativity, it's also used in quantum field theory, though it's defined from a different way. It's derived in a different way, usually from Noether's theorem. And from Noether's theorem, you derive the energy momentum tensor of the form T mu nu, I'm using contravariant indices, is equal to the sum over n dl d d mu phi sub n d nu phi sub n minus g mu nu L. Now this part's all fine because the metric is symmetric, but this part is not manifestly symmetric. And because of this, typically the definition that you see in the quantum field theory textbooks of the energy momentum tensor is kind of just for academic purposes, because it doesn't really help you unless it's a symmetric tensor. So people have gone out of their way to find a way to modify the energy momentum tensor such that it retains its symmetry properties. It's called the Belafonte tensor. But anyways, it's also used in quantum field theory. It's a bit more subtle, but I've taken enough time. So thank you, Toby, for letting me talk about the tensor. It's definitely one of my favorites. Be sure to let us know in the comment section what yours is, and I'll see you guys there.